Hebrew text describes the deadly rain of great stones, or stones of Barad, which have also fallen as one of the Egypt plagues. Rabbinical tradition is clear in noting that Barad were not mere hailstones. At the time of the Exodus, Barad fell mingled with fire, and the stones themselves were said to be hot, which would leave only one possibility. Meteorites. The Mexican annals of Cuauhtitlan describe how a cosmic catastrophe was accompanied by a hail of stones. The description of such a catastrophe is found in the Visuddhimagga, a Buddhist text on the world cycles. When a world cycle is destroyed by wind, there arises a wind. First it raises a fine dust, then fine sand, then coarse sand, then grit, stones, up to boulders, as large as trees. Middle East preserved only very fragments of testimony about the Great Flood, but Burma and China, for instance, also recalled the rain of fire. Pahpalva, the sacred book of the Mayas, narrates, "People were drowned in a sticky substance raining from the sky, and then there was a great din of fire above their heads. The entire population of the land was annihilated." A similar account is preserved in the annals of Cuauhtitlan. The age which ended in the rain of fire was called the Sun of Fire Rain in Siberia. The Vogels carried this memory through millennia. God sent a sea of fire upon the earth. In the East Indies, the Aboriginal tribes relate that in the remote past, water of fire rained from the sky. With very few exceptions, all men died. South American Indians almost utterly lack myths about creation of the world. More characteristic is a story about its reforming. Present world is usually preceded by some kind of cosmic disaster that destroyed previous world. Myths about catastrophe are widespread throughout South America. Most often they speak of fire or flood, sometimes also about descending cold or darkness. During the cataclysm, stones fell upon people, bewildered domestic animals attacked their masters. Aztecs, for example, defined four stages of world history, four epochs. 1. Jaguar, which ended with jaguars killing the tribe of giants that inhabited Earth at that time. 2. Wind, which ended with hurricanes and turning of humans into monkeys. 3. Torrent, which ended in worldwide fiery holocaust. 4. Water, which ended with flood. Modern era, earthquake, is due to and with disastrous cataclysms. North and South America's carry on spoken, as well as written, legends about the end of mankind. Indians of South America saw how sky fell to earth, swarms of stones from the sky, height mountains jutting skyward in a wink. People tumbled about in flaming air between their dwellings set afire, and most of them died instantly in this hell. The same as in China, earth inclined and went underwater. People rushed to the mountain peaks, but there they found themselves cut off from the world by lava flows, mudslides and stone avalanches. Assemblage of human and animal bodies, uprooted giant trees was poured by flows of mud originating in ashes from volcanic eruptions. Those who managed to survive all this somehow, died of hunger and freeze. Black smoke covered the earth and turned day into night for many days. Few survivors did not recognize the earth. Ancient inhabitants of Mexico knew about three great upheavals, of which third was the greatest. Codex Chumulpopoca tells about rain of fire. Everything was burned and a wrath of stones and sand precipitated afterwards. Great wave has risen and chased them, for they had forgotten their creator, they were killed and drowned. Tar and pitch poured from the sky, earth descended into gloom, heavy torrents rained day and night, people rushed from one place to another in terror, they climbed on top of their dwellings, but their houses collapsed and entombed them. They strive to seek hide in caves, but caves closed up. This way they all died. That's probably the explanation for findings of numerous animal and human bones in caves around the world. They did not live there. They sought shelter and, being cut off, died there. In other Aztec scripture it is written, it happened in the year Quetzalcoatl, on the day of four rains. People tumbled and died, seized by fiery rain. They turned into birds. Sun was barely seen, all houses were swept by fire, and whole humankind died. Guatemalan Quechua. Then great deluge started, accompanied by heavy downpour of rain and tar. People, desperate and insane, rushed and tumbled in seek of salvation. They climbed trees, but elements threw them around like specks. This is how the destruction of humankind happened. And Codex Laetilia reads, mankind did not ever cease to exist, even in the days when the end of the world happened, and in honor of this event is Pelkishta festivity, a celebration of revival of the human race. Is there any factual basis for any of this? Most certainly. Mountain building is evidence in and of itself. These mountains are like pushed together. When you are in airplane and look down at foothills, for instance, they almost look like a rumpled blanket, like someone just took a blanket and pushed it and rumpled it. Mountain cliffs, which rise sheer, in many cases thousands of feet, represent tearing of solid rock. These stands before mankind, who even make a hobby of scaling their heights, ignored in their deeper meaning. Have any experiments been done to determine how much force would be required to tear rock of this depth? Mountain building occurs during rapid subduction of one plate under another. Mountain building has occurred over many shifts, nudged up repeatedly, as the given shift jerked any particular land mass. Thus, it is a cumulative effect, not a one-time result. Those areas in the world where mountain building has occurred in the past are obvious, as sheer rock is broken into cliffs, or jut skyward like a missile, or monstrous rocks are in a jumble. The rock is fresh, not weathered and broken down. Often these are called new mountain ranges or old ranges, to differentiate. Why would a new range become an old range? The Himalayas are a good example of a spot on the earth where mountain building invariably occurs. Thus, these are both old and new mountain, never escaping fresh discombobulating. The mountains lining the west coast of both North and South America are likewise never at peace, as they form the cutting edge of land being pushed into the Pacific, where plates in the Pacific are being pushed under this edge. Each time the Pacific shortens, these ranges go through rock and roll, with new mountain building occurring. Volcanic loci in the United States West, that have been active during the Quaternary, Black, Gray areas have been active during the Holocene. Mediterranean is a weak spot in the plates, where movement has invariably occurred. Alps were built due to bumping between the plates on the move. As Africa is a very solid land mass, Europe invariably was the loser during this bumping. Subduction can release pressure by pushing forward separating flakes of land. Push a wooden block against some flaky pastry, and watch the top flake simply fly forward, separating from the pastry. That's how the Alps and the Carpathians were built. There is a mystery still unsolved on the plateau of Lake Titicaca. Ruins of a great city, at the southern side of the lake. The city covered a large area, built by highly skilled masons, and with the use of enormous stones. Today, deserted coastlines and docks of this one-time busy port are towering at unthinkable height, 4,000 meters above sea level. At present time, the plateau is inhospitable and almost sterile. The region is only capable of sustaining a scanty population of hardy mountaineers and laborers. The conservative view among evolutionists and geologists is that mountain building is a slow process, observable in geological time scale. In the case of Tiahuanaco, however, the considerable change in altitude apparently occurred after the city was built, and this could not have been the result of a slow process that required millions of years to produce a visible alteration. Once Tiahuanaco was at the water's edge, as Lake's Titicaca old strand line discloses. But this strand line is tilted, and in other places it is more than 360 feet above the present level of the lake. There are numerous raised beaches, and stress should be put on the freshness of many of the strand lines, and the modern character of fossils that occur there. Further investigation established that the plateau was at one time at sea level, or 12,500 feet lower than it is today. Originally its lakes were a part of the sea gulf. It looks like sometime in the remote past, the entire Altiplano with its lakes rose from the ocean bottom. At some other point, a city was built there, and terraces were laid out around it. Then in another disturbance, the mountains were thrust up and the area became uninhabitable. The last upheaval took place in early historical period, after Tiahuanaco had been built. The lakes were dragged up, and the Altiplano and the entire chain of the Andes rose to their present height. In many places of the world, the seacoast shows either submerged or raised beaches. The previous surf line is seen on the rock of raised beaches. From observations on beaches in numerous places all over the world, R.A. Daly concluded that there was a change in the ocean level, which dropped 16 to 20 feet, 3,500 years ago. In Daly's opinion, the cause lies in the sinking of the level of all seas on the globe. Alternatively, Daly thinks it could have resulted from a deepening of the oceans or from an increase in their areas. Bones of whale have been found 140 meters above sea level, north of Lake Ontario. A skeleton of another whale was discovered in Vermont, more than 155 meters above sea level. And still another in the Montreal-Quebec area, about 186 meters above sea level. Although the humphrey whale and beluga occasionally enter the mouth of the St. Lawrence, they do not climb hills. During the pole shift, when the Earth will move, in just under an hour, more than a quarter turn, earthquakes of great magnitude, hurricane-force winds, and giant tidal waves, worldwide, occur. Zeta Talk. Stories about worldwide flood are present in peoples around the world, and in sources older than the Bible. Most often they are found in people that lived in coastal areas. Sri Lanka, China, Japan, Hawaii, Egypt, Greece, Ireland, both Americas. Almost two-thirds of these myths are fully independent from Mesopotamian and Hebrew versions, although they all carry almost identical storyline. These myths also often mention volcanic activity, earthquakes, freezing. Excavations of Sumerian city of Ur revealed traces of culture following the layer of untouched soil, 2.5 meters deep. It was the remnants of the culture much older than Sumerians. Actually, Sumerian culture was based on this preceding one. It is most likely that these ancient people witnessed and survived the flood and passed on to Sumerians their culture in the legend about the flood. numerous layers excavated in Shinadar Cave, on the Iraq-Iranian border, confirm the occurrence of four deluges that happen regularly, starting from 65,000 BC. This date is also the date of the oldest cultural layer, and the most recent one, after which men did not ever inhabit the cave, dates back to Xi millennia BC. This is apparently the date of the last flood. But the most important is the fact that the cave, which has never been a seabed, contains cultural layers, interlaid by river silt, sand, gravel and shells. E-rings. This is indicated by clusters of extremely narrow rings, which suggest extremely cold growing seasons. A band of these narrow rings occurred around 1628 BC and lasted about 6 years in parts of Europe, Asia, and North America. These dates may coincide with the collapse of Bronze Age civilizations across Eurasia. They may also be recalled in the biblical Book of Exodus and contemporary records from China. Many trees exhibited the worst growth, the narrowest rings, of their lifetimes, starting in 1628 BC. We can determine the time necessary for lakes to collect mud, deposited by melting glaciers, for rivers to build their deltas, for waterfalls to cut their channels and to remove the bedrock, for lakes without outlets, to accumulate their salts. Research by W. A. Johnston of the Niagara River bed revealed that the present channel was cut by the falls less than 4,000 years ago. Careful study of the Bear River Delta showed the age of the delta was 3,600 years. A study by Claude Jones of the Great Lakes showed that these lakes have existed only 3,500 years. The same result was obtained on Owen Lake in California. Van Winkle obtained the same result on Abbott and Summer Lakes in Oregon. A 1513 map drawn by Piri Reis, a famous Turkish naval admiral, shows the western coast of Africa, the eastern coast of South America, and the northern coast of Antarctica. The northern coastline of Antarctica is perfectly detailed. The most puzzling, however, is that the map shows the coastline without the ice cover. Geological evidence confirms that the latest date Queen Maud Land could have been charted in an ice-free state is 4000 BC. How can this be explained? Piri Reis gives us the answer in a series of notes written by his own hand on the map itself. Here he tells us that he was not responsible for the original surveying and cartography. He honestly admits that his own map was derived and compiled from a large number of source maps, some by contemporary or near-contemporary explorers, including Christopher Columbus, and others were documents of great antiquity dating back to the 4th century BC or earlier. Moreover, on a 1737 map, made by French cartographer Philippe Bouchet, one can see a strait that divides Antarctic continent into two parts. Its presence under the ice cover was discovered only in recent decades. Like Reis, Bouchet claimed that he used ancient Greek originals in composing his own map. 7,500 years ago, that is, two pole shifts back, there was no Black Sea. Robert Ballard and his team of undersea archaeologists found remnants of buildings and pottery near the shores of Turkey, Bulgaria and Ukraine. Before some 7,500 years ago, there was a sweetwater lake where now the Black Sea is. The water level was 20-30 meters lower. Before the flooding it was an arid sunburnt plain. Around 5,460 BC, there was a series of earthquakes in different regions of the planet. One of them subducted southern edge of a small Scythian subplate, a Breccia flake, making it submerge below sea level. Waters of the Mediterranean rushed into this newly formed depression, rising 1.5 meters a day, and in a short time inundating immense areas of former lowlands. Furthermore, similar occurrences brought Mediterranean into existence. Mediterranean as known to us today, was formed around 5.3 million years ago, when waters of the Atlantic broke through Gibraltar and inundated a huge basin. It is known to have happened due to tectonic movements in the region. Recent study by Barcelona University geologists indicates that it took mere couple of thousands of years for Mediterranean plates to become subducted and covered with water. 90% of Mediterranean waters flowed in just several decades, and in some instances waters rose few meters a day. According to the World Book Encyclopedia, an unknown civilization that had an alphabet that has yet to be deciphered lived in the Indus Valley. Around 1500 BC they disappeared, inhabitants leaving their cities. Around 1500 BC a civilization arose on the banks of the Huanghe River in north-central China. According to Encarta, the first dynasty of Babylon ended in 1595 BC. In the Semitic culture, Hyksos was deposed in 1570 BC, and the Jewish exodus led by Moses happened shortly thereafter. This featured a river Nile filled with blood and water they could not drink. The Cycladic settlement on the island of Thera was destroyed by a great volcanic eruption about 1500 BC. According to M.I. Farley, author of Early Greece, 1970, there was total catastrophe all over Crete about 1400 BC. The Santorini eruption, about 1500 BC, was several times greater in scope than the 1883 Krakatoa eruption. Ruins of almost all cities, dating back to 2nd millennia BC, bear traces of fire and destruction. The city of Mycenae, in Greece, did already exist in the mid-2nd millennia BC. Around 1600 BC, barbarian tribes of Dorians invaded Greece, destroying Mycenae and other cities. With the Dorian invasion came the collapse of Greek culture. For a few centuries stone buildings were not built, pottery became crude, knowledge of writing was lost. In the 29th year of King Qi, the last ruler of the earliest recorded Chinese dynasty, the sun was dimmed. King Qi lacked virtue. The sun was distressed. During the last years of Qi, ice formed in summer mornings, and frosts in the sixth month, July. Heavy rainfall toppled temples and buildings. Heaven gave severe orders. The sun and moon were untimely. Hot and cold weather arrived in disorder. The five cereal crops withered and died. Written during the reign of Emperor Qin, circa 1600 BC. On Huanghe banks in China, numerous entombments of the 2nd millennia BC are found. The plate of that time reads, "We burn a slave for the rain to fall on earth." Mohenjo-Daro was one of the largest city settlements of the Indus Valley civilization, existing at the same time as ancient Egypt, Mesopotamia, and Crete. Indus Valley civilization blossomed over the centuries, but suddenly went into decline around 1900 BC. Mohenjo-Daro was built around 2600 BC, and abandoned around 1900 BC. The placement of unearthed groups of skeletons suggests that the city population led absolutely normal way of life. Immediately before the tragic events, people peacefully walked the streets. The catastrophe happened suddenly. There is evidence that suggests that city was destroyed by enormous earthquake. Stirred up land blocked the Indus River, then came disastrous volcanic eruptions. Stones bear signs of fires and powerful blast. These eruptions turn Indus waters into mud that cover the whole fertile valley. There are great cities discovered in Central America and China, standing abandoned in the jungles or under the shifting sands, with no explanation for where the inhabitants went. stories of their past glory exceeds the humble peasantry of today. Buildings left not repaired, as there are no more hands to do so. They crumble, stones eroding and covered by blowing volcanic dust, endless rains eventually making it into inviting soil for rooting plants. They had irrigation, water flowing through the city, so why did it collapse? Was it a great plague? Was it a terrible drought? Did someone come and slaughter them all? Was there a great civilization that fell? Yes, on all continents there are remnants of pole shifts, where great civilizations have fallen in the past. The survivors wander, in search of a better life. They are often confused, as they don't know what has hit them. They are sure this is a local event and they are off to find the land where the sun is shining and the grain is growing, the land of milk and honey. They left, in search for a better life. Two titanic volcanic explosions occurred in the Mediterranean around the middle of the 2nd millennia BC, one on Mount Vesuvius, and the other on the island of Thera, near Crete. Each dwarfed the great explosion of Krakatoa in 1883. Santorini eruption destroyed the island of Thera in the Aegean Sea circa 1500-1600 BC, 3,650 years before present. Researchers suggest Santorini eruption might be associated with the collapse of the Minoan civilization. Tree ring evidence for several years of intense cold beginning in 1627 BC, and the Jewish exodus in the times of Moses, described in the Bible. Circa 1750 BC, a rebellion of beggars and slaves occurred in Egypt. People revolted against the emperor's power, which was installed by God. Jewish exodus happened at the time of the last passage of Planet X, but what is not well known is the reason for the exodus. Exodus did not occur because slaves, and a large group of slaves, old women and children among them, just decided to leave one day and walk away from their masters, and get miles away into a desert. Slaves attempting to escape are punished in a manner that will serve as a lesson to others contemplating such an escape attempt. The exodus occurred because their masters were devastated and distracted by problems so severe as to take their minds entirely off their slaves. Would this have been a flood of Nile or a plague of locusts or even celebration where all got drunk? Nothing in the normal course of Egyptian society would have created a situation where the Jews could have left, en masse, or even a situation where they all would have had the courage to leave. They left because the passage of the 12th planet imposed first a long night, and then horrendous earthquakes and volcanic eruptions in nearby volcanoes. Moses was guided and warned of the signs to watch for. He felt responsible for a number of people he led, and was desperate to get them to safety as they left Egypt, knowing the retaliation that would come to escaping slaves. A man of this quality was given guidance from above. Chaos reigned, the very type of chaos that every government in the world fears. Guards left their posts, and household servants stole from their masters and crept away in the seemingly never-ending night. The rulers held their heads in worry and discussed among themselves how they might placate the gods. Hysterical troops, unable to comprehend what was happening to them, were in no mood to placate their commanders, and thus the military was into infighting for some time. It was not until the rotation of the earth was re-established that the Egyptian rulers and their military leaders were able to regain control of the troops. By that time, as history well tells, the Jewish exodus was a success. The last passage of the 12th planet and Jewish exodus is described in excessive details in the book called the Qumran, which is compiled of manuscripts saved and safeguarded by a group called the Chaldeans.
The dark days began with the last visitation of the destroyer, and they were foretold by strange omens in the skies. All men were silent and went about with pale faces. Fear walked the land and women became barren with terror, they could not conceive, and those with child aborted. The days of stillness were followed by a time when the noise of trumpeting and shrilling was heard in the heavens, and the people became as frightened beasts without a headsman. The dead were no longer sacred and were thrown into the waters. He who grew no grain now owned a storehouse full. Cattle were left unattended to roam into strange pastures, and men ignored their marks and slew the beasts of their neighbors. No man owned anything. The public records were cast forth and destroyed, and no man knew who were slaves and who were masters. Plague was throughout the land, the river was bloody and blood was everywhere. Those who did drink from the river vomited it up. The dust tore wounds in the skin of man and beast.
Men, stricken with terror, went mad at the awful sight in the heavens. They were loosed from their senses and dashed about, crazed, not knowing what they did. The doom shape, called the Destroyer, in Egypt, was seen in all the lands thereabouts. In color it was bright and fiery, in appearance changing and unstable. It twisted about itself like a coil, like water bubbling into a pool from an underground supply, and all men agree it was a most fearsome sight. It was not a great comet or a lucent star, being more like a fiery body of flame.
On its arrival Nibiru became visible in the day skies, first as a second sun, or winged globe, and then took a shape of a writhing fiery dragon described by the ancients. This tale of space debris consists of dust, gravel, meteorites, boulders and small asteroids, and sweeps the earth during the passage with hail of stones. The people will scatter in madness. They will hear the trumpet and battle cry of the destroyer and will seek refuge within dens in the earth. In the glow of the destroyer the earth was filled with redness. When it passed, men rose up against those in authority and fled from the cities to swell in tents in the outlands. Egypt lacked great men to deal with the times. The slaves left. Their multitude moved in the gloom of a half-dawn, under a mantle of fine swirling gray ash. The night was a night of fear and dread, for there was a high moaning above and fire sprang up from the ground.
We find additional details in the Apura Papyrus. A surviving Egyptian scribe, Papyrus Leiden 334. The doorkeepers say, "Let us go and plunder. Indeed, the face is pale. What the ancestors foretold has arrived. The land is full of confederates, and a man goes to plow with his shield. Indeed, the plunderer everywhere, and the servant takes what he finds. Indeed, the Nile overflows, yet none plow for it. Everyone says, 'We do not know what will happen throughout the land.' Indeed, poor men have become owners of wealth, and he who could not make sandals for himself is now a possessor of riches. Indeed, noblemen are in distress, while the poor man is full of joy. Every town says, 'Let us suppress the powerful among us. Let us suppress the powerful among us. Lichaim. Let us expel our rulers.' Indeed, the land turns around as does a potter's wheel. The robber is a possessor of riches and the rich man has become a plunderer. Indeed, the river is blood, yet men drink of it. Men shrink from human beings and thirst after water. Indeed, the desert is throughout the land, the homes are laid waste, and barbarians from abroad have come to Egypt. Indeed, gold and lapis lazuli, silver and turquoise, carnelian and amethyst, ibid stone and are strung on the necks of maid servants. Good things are throughout the land, yet housewives say, 'Oh that we had something to eat!' Indeed, hair has fallen out for everybody, and the man of rank can no longer be distinguished from him who is nobody. Indeed, great and small say, I wish I might die. Little children say, He should not have caused me to live. 1.
The face of the land was battered and devastated by a hail of stones, which smashed down all that stood in the path of the torrent. They swept down in hot showers, and strange flowing fire ran along the ground in their wake. The gloom of a long night spread a dark mantle of blackness which extinguished every ray of light. None knew when it was day and when it was night, for the sun cast no shadow. Men and their dwelling places were gone, only sky boulders and red earth remained where once they were, but amidst all the desolation a few survived, for man is not easily destroyed. They crept out from caves and came down from the mountainsides. Their eyes were wild and their limbs trembled, their bodies shook and their tongues lacked control. Their faces were twisted and the skin hung loose on their bones. They were as mad and wild beasts driven into an enclosure before flames. They knew no law, being deprived of all the wisdom they once had, and those who had guided them were gone. When the light of the sun pierced the earth's shroud, bathing the land in its revitalizing glory, the earth again knew night and day, for there were now times of light, and times of darkness. Strange people came up against Egypt, and none stood to fight, for strength and courage were gone. The invaders came up because of the wrath of heaven, which had laid their land waste. They enslaved all who were left, the old, young men, and boys. They oppressed the people, and their delight was in mutilation and torture. Pharaoh abandoned his hopes and fled into the wilderness. He lived a goodly life among the sand wanderers, and wrote books. Good times came again, even under the invaders, and ships sailed upstream. The air was purified, and the land became filled again with growing things. And thus says the Lord, So forth for all days of earth, the sowing and plowing, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night, will not cease to be. Genesis 8:22. The Greek Solon visited Egypt and an old priest spoke to him. You are all young in your minds, which hold no store of old belief, based on long tradition, no knowledge hoary with age. The reason is this. There have been, and will be thereafter, many and diverse destructions of mankind, the greatest by fire and water, though other, lesser ones, are due to countless other causes. Thus, the story current also in your part of the world, that Phaethon, child of the sun, once harnessed his father's chariot, but could not guide it on his father's course, and so burnt up everything on the face of the earth, and was himself consumed by the thunderbolt. This legend has the air of a fable. But the truth behind it is a deviation of the bodies that revolve in heaven round the earth, and a destruction, occurring at long intervals, of things on earth by a great conflagration. With you, and other peoples, again and again life has only lately been enriched. When once more, after the usual period of years, the torrents from heaven sweep down like a pestilence, leaving only the rude and unlettered among you. And so you start again like children, knowing nothing of what existed in ancient times here or in your own country. Your people remember only one deluge, though there were many, earlier.
And yet the scientific community continues to claim that Earth changes happen gently, inch by inch, at the pace experienced during the memory of current civilization. The reason lies in the deep desire of mankind to avoid thinking about the Earth's past cataclysms. Men forget the days of the Destroyer. Only the wise know where it went, and that it will return, in its appointed hour. Colbrin.